there's a book just over your shoulder that's carefully been placed there. Can you pick the book up and tell me about it?
Right, great book. You should buy the newer version of this. Sorry, brief commercial announcement. Yeah, sure. I think I mentioned at some point in our conversation the fact that the people working on Multics, well, Multics was sort of the second version of time sharing that was done at MIT with collaboration of Bell Labs and General Electric. Very big system for providing, in effect, a computing utility for programmers. Multics was actually being written in high-level languages. They started with PL1, which was not a good choice, and then they moved to BCPL, a language which was developed, in fact, by Martin Richards, Cambridge. The people doing that who were at Bell Labs, in particular Ken Thompson and Dennis Ritchie, had gotten used to the idea that you could write really interesting operating system kinds of software and tools that supported it in high-level languages. You weren't writing assembly language. And so when they started working on Unix, this very small stripped-down version that was done at Bell Labs, they were at the same time exploring the use of high-level languages. And there were a variety of these. There was a language called B, which was the first attempt. It was done by Ken Thompson, a very simple language, and I suppose you could say it was sort of like a stripped-down version of BCPL. It's, you know, kind of a weak naming convention there. And so you could do interesting things with B, but it wasn't quite powerful enough. And in particular, it was an interpreter, not a compiler, and that meant it didn't generate machine code for the particular machine it was running on. It was just a program that interpreted what it was trying to say. So it meant it ran relatively slowly. The other thing is that the language did not support the architecture of newer machines that were showing up, in particular the PDP-11. Newer machines, instead of having everything in the machine be a single size of, in effect, integer, let's say 16 bits or something like that, they had different sizes that were the machine would efficiently and naturally manipulate, 8 bits, 16 bit, maybe 32 bits. And the language B didn't reflect that. And so Dennis Ritchie undertook to design what amounted to a version of B that was richer and had mechanisms in the language to say, this is an 8-bit quantity, this is a 16-bit quantity, basically the char and int types that you see in the early versions of C. And so he wrote a compiler for that, and then with the compiler in hand, they started to rewrite the operating system itself in C. And this took a while, something in the order of 6 months to get that working. And at that point, then you've got the operating system, and of course all kinds of other critical core software written in a high-level language rather than in assembly language. And that's important for all kinds of reasons. One, it means that it's just a lot easier for lots of people to see what the code does. You don't need so much expertise because it's in the high-level language. And the other thing is that it's portable in the sense that if somebody makes a C compiler for a different kind of machine, different architecture, then you can recompile whatever your program is for that new architecture, and in that way you can move your program to a different machine. Now, this has always been the advantage of high-level languages, but now you could do it for the operating system. And that meant that Unix, the operating system, no longer was only PDP-11, but could run on a variety of other machines as well.
I think the concept of having a high-level language I get, right? You can compile it down to hexes and machine code that tells the processors to do stuff.
Right.
And if you have a different compiler for a different machine, it just changes what those hex codes is.
Correct.
That right?
That's exactly right.
So it should be really simple to understand how you write an OS in a high-level language, but is it a bit like making a sharper tool and using that sharper tool to make a sharper tool?
Yeah, right. I think, in fact, and the complication is in building, in writing an operating system in a high-level language and translating it into, let's say, multiple different architectures, is there's a lot of detail to get right there, and there are some things which the high-level language just doesn't support. So you need a little tiny bit of assembly language assist for any given operating system. The one that's more like the conceptual problem that you were explaining well is, how does the compiler itself get started? Because, of course, the C compiler is written in C. And so there's the how do you get it started, and your idea of the sharper tool making yet a sharper tool and so on, is metaphorically the right idea. Because what you do is you say, I wrote some code in C on paper. Let me mechanically translate that into something that will process a bit more of C code and then bootstrap myself up from that. So it's a bootstrapping process. And I've never done it, so take me with a grain of salt on that. But that's the basic idea.
Okay, so and then tell me about this book. How did this come about then?
So
I'm looking, I think that's a relatively early edition.
That's the first edition, yeah. Yes. This one isn't, actually. Oh, dear. This, however, is the 24th printing, so...
Who's just point out a professor for just brought in a pen for the autograph there.
Okay, I will autograph it. How did the book come about? Somewhere early on in this process of people building interesting languages, I got intrigued by the idea of how do you explain those languages to other people? And so I wrote tutorial documents. I wrote a tutorial document on B so that people could learn B, because Ken Thompson and, to a lesser degree, Dennis didn't write a tremendous amount of documentation, let's say. It was spare, and there was not much tutorial stuff. So I wrote a tutorial document on B. That was useful. When C came along, then I wrote a tutorial document on C. And at some point, I had already written, I guess, a couple of books at that point, and it seemed like that there might be a market for a C book. And so I twisted Dennis Ritchie's arm into writing the book with me. And that is the smartest thing I ever did in my whole life. No ambiguity. So we took my tutorial document as kind of a piece of it. We took his reference manual, which is a really excellent reference manual, as a big piece of it, took that verbatim, and then we filled in material in the middle to explain the various parts of the language at more length. And we published that. We wrote it in 1977, published it at the beginning of 78. And of course, it was done with all of the document preparation tools that we had been working on over the years. And so it had mathematical expressions in it using EQN. It had tables of things like operators using Mike Lesk's TBL program. The first edition predates PIC, the picture drawing language. But the second edition has PIC pictures and so on. So, is this incestuous, or is this building on what other people have done? I don't know, but that's how it came about. And I remember talking to the editor. This was published by Prentice Hall with Carl Karlstrom, the editor there. And I remember a discussion with him about how many copies do you think this will sell? And I had no idea. Well, maybe 5,000. So it's done better than that, just as well.
It was never an A because it was B was based on...
There was a language... Steve Johnson, who was all part of this, the creator of Yak, Steve Johnson spent a sabbatical at the University of Waterloo in Ontario, and he came back with a language... I don't know where... Somebody else had done it, a language there called A, but it was spelled E-H. A bit of Canadian humor, I guess.